Hello, I'm Reverend Sam. I'm your host on this program, The Secret of Glory and Power. Last week, I started on the story of Samson. I started on the story of Samson because I think that's what God put in my heart. And then I want to also continue from where we stopped last week. I was talking about the fact that Samson never had an army. Samson never had an army. I spoke to him about the fact that it's true that he had gifting. He was anointed, but he never developed nobody. So by the time he died, nobody could continue what he started. Nobody could continue what he started. And I felt I should let you know this at this very moment, that you can take advantage of this program to promote your goods and services. What you do, maybe you have business, you have idea, you can promote them on this platform by way of advertisement. There'll be a number on the screen. You can send us a mail. You can send me a mail, call that phone number so that we can talk together on how you can advertise your program on this platform. And listen, I have a glory. My glory is such that for over 20 years now, everyone who do business with me always end up having enlightenment and progress. Maybe you have been praying for growth for your business and you don't seem to know the way out. Bring your advert to this program, and I'm very, very sure that it won't take long. You'll begin to smile because my God will show you the way out. As you help this program to expand by bringing advert, so also will your business also expand. I believe that in the name of Jesus. So anything you have in life, your gifting, your talent, have a burden to share it. And parents, like I said, look at your children and discover what gifting they have and encourage them. Don't say, no, I want my daughter to be a doctor. No. You see, you are not supposed to determine what your children are supposed to become. If you impose upon them what you think you want them to become, they will only end up becoming the second best. But if you can just take time to begin to pray and observe them, you will discover what they love to do. And anything can give them good income if it is what they love. I was watching a film recently, and the woman was talking to a group of people in the class. He was talking to a lady that she wanted her to know how to recite poem. She was a rapper. But this school was a school where they learned how to write poem. The lecturer said, listen, your money is in my hand. Your money is in the whole world. There's a lot of money in the hand of many people for you. Develop your skill. People will pay for it. I caught that word and I kept it in my heart. I said, my idea is worth paying for. All I need is number one. Privately, I should develop it. Let me tell you one thing. Many years before I started a television program, I will face the mirror, you know, the mirror, and I'll be preaching to the mirror. Because I was telling myself, one day I'm going to preach on television. When I first appeared on the cable TV in 2005 in Nigeria, it was a vision come true, you know. And ever since then, I've always been doing that. You've got to be able to develop what you have inside you. Develop it. And parents, observe your children. Make them to be the best in whatever they can be. Because everything is not money. Let your child have fulfillment. Let them have a sense of accomplishment. Because it is when they are fulfilled that they can use whatever skill they have, whatever gift they have, it is then they can use it to serve God. If your child is good in numbers, let them go for accounting-related jobs. They will use it. If your children are good in other areas, let them go for what they are good in. Don't impose things on them. Because when you do, very soon, when your children are of age, they are still going to go back to their passion, but they will be angry that you have wasted their life by pushing them in the wrong direction. Samson never developed an army. You should always learn to develop people. Develop people. Women, mothers. It is your primary responsibility to be able to train the children, because your children spend more time with you than their dad. I know it's an irony, because any child that succeeds is the father's child. Anyone that failed is the mother's child. But women are given the grace to raise children. That's why the Bible says a A wise woman will build her home. That's why Apostle Paul was telling Timothy and Titus that they should tell the women that they should be good keepers of the home, they should train their children, they should love their husband. It's your job. I know that you go to work. I know that in this Western world you have to work. I know, but I don't think you should allow the quest for money to make you relinquish your primary responsibility. Don't forget, you will give account to God on the last day. Now, another thing I want us to learn from Samson is that Samson had anger problem. Can you imagine someone that said he saw a woman that he loved and then he compelled the parent to go and pay the bride price? And by the time the engagement day came, all of them were sitting. I can imagine the family of the bride and all their friends and all the specially invited guests. All of them were there. And because something happened, Samson grew angry. Do you know what he did? He walked out of engagement party and went back home. Just picture it. The embarrassment he gave his parents. The people that went with his parents. He just left the party. And the story tells us that because they brought the bride price and the woman's family has collected the bride price, what they did was to give the wife to Samson's best man. So the best man was perplexed. Just imagine, the best man was there and the groom just walked away out of anger. The Bible says anger rests in the bosom of a fool. I used to be angry a lot before. Until one day I was reading the book of Proverbs. And then I read that scripture I just quoted now. And I had a voice called Samuel. I said, yes. He said, are you a fool? I said, no. Oh, yeah, no. He said, then stop getting angry without good reason. So I knew it was God telling me my anger is destructive. If I don't work on it, I will lose opportunities. People will always make you angry. That's a lesson you have to learn. Don't expect perfection from anybody. Don't expect perfection from your wife. Don't expect perfection from your friends. Don't expect perfection from your husband. Don't expect perfection from your colleague. T.D. Jakes said something one time, and I learned from it. He said, in his mind, he has conditioned his mind in such a way that he gives everybody 50-50 chance. He said what he meant is this. In his mind, he already said to himself, 50% possibility that this person will disappoint me. 50% possibility that this person will impress me. Say, so if the person disappoints me, it's just the other 50%. And if the person impressed me, it's the other 50%. So he's never surprised when people betray him. He said, I expect it to happen. And he's never surprised when somebody impresses him. I expect it to happen. That's what he said. He conditioned his mind in such a way that he's able to deal with betrayal and disappointments. That's what I'm trying to encourage you on. Listen, if your dream is to be great, the anger of a great man will destroy a lot of things. Imagine if Trump get angry and just get out of control. Imagine the chaos that will happen to America. I learned this lesson from this man, Abiola, in Nigeria before he died. Somebody asked him, they said, sir, if your employee just come and they misbehave, how will you take it? He said, I will just tell myself that maybe his wife make him angry before he left home. So when they came to work, he brought that anger to work. He said, maybe he entered public bus and then somebody make him angry. Maybe things didn't turn out well for him. That's why he's not at his best. And he said, but why do you do that? He said, because he wants his mind to always be at peace. I learned that lesson. He said, so he always make up good reasons why people disappoint him. They said, can you explain? He said, if you disappoint me, for instance, I will say in my mind, you don't mean to disappoint me. Maybe something just happened to you and you don't know how to control yourself. That's why you did what you did. He said, that way, it's easy for him to overlook your fault. It's easy for him to forgive. And I said to myself, it's been a long time I heard it from him before he died. I said, no way, this is the wisdom of a wise man. And I pick it, I kept it to myself. So right now, people really offend me. In fact, it got to a level that people that work with me felt that I always have a good reason for every bad situation. And I said to them, I'm just trying to keep my mind focused. I don't want bad things in my mind. Samson had anger problem. Do you have anger problem? People will mess up. But you can control yourself. Nelson Mandela, you know, when he was in prison, and we're told that he said that one of the soldiers one day was just peeing on him. You know, they dug the ground and they buried him to this place. Only his head was up. The rest was inside the ground. And the soldier was peeing on him. Mandela said he began to smile and laugh. The soldier was like, what? Why are you laughing? What's so funny? Nelson said, he told that soldier, you know what? You can pee on me, but you don't have the power to determine how I feel about what you are doing to me. I said, this is the wisdom of the wise. Do you know how many great projects you have abandoned because somebody messed up and then just let go? Do you know how many opportunities you have walked away from because you had a story or something about somebody that you thought will be perfect, will be mature, and you had something that is a bit messy, and you said, no, I can't get myself involved with these kind of people. There's no perfect person on earth. And somebody said to me one time, everybody had their good times, and everybody had their bad times. I'm simply saying, work on your anger. And don't expect perfection from people. If you do, you won't live. If you are married long enough, you and your wife will fight. I'm not talking about physical fight. You will have argument. You will say things that will hurt your wife's feeling. Your wife will say things that will hurt your feeling. But at the end of the day, if you want your marriage to work, you have to forgive one another and you have to learn to let go. It's the same way working with colleagues, developing great ideas, raising children. Wow. The next thing I want to talk about Samson is that he should have married another woman from Israel and maintain one sexual partner. He said that he wanted to marry the Philistine woman. At the end of the day, he walked out of the marriage. He never took the woman home. And instead of him to now say, okay, you know what? I think it's better for me to learn how to do things right. I think I'd better just look for a nice woman among the people of Israel and get married to her so that she can take care of me. I can have sexual companionship and then I can know I'm working in the will of God for my life. You know what he did? Instead of looking for God-fearing woman to marry, he began to sleep from one harlot house to another. And the problem is that because he's anointed, nobody could talk. Because you see, the mystery of the anointing is that even if the anointed person is making mistake, if you anger them and they curse you, the curse will still stick. So people are afraid of him. I mean, one man carried the main gate of a whole city, carried it upon his shoulder and climbed a mountain with it. Won't you be afraid of that person? So nobody was able to talk. And instead for him to look for a godly woman and stay with that woman, he just began to sleep around. Maybe you also have the same problem. Your wife is not doing right. You are not getting the best from your wife. And instead of you to work on how your marriage can work, how your relationship can work, how you can become best of friends, you start looking for other women outside. You start looking for other men outside. Let me tell you the truth. It doesn't end well. And there's something I know about sex. If you maintain one sexual partner, you will be younger, you will be healthier. But when you have multiple sex partners, you will look ragged, you will look burnt out. And spiritually also, anyone you sleep with, you carry their problem. So if this woman has, maybe has one occultic problem, once you sleep with her, you are a part of, because it's a covenant. Blood flow through blood. You go to another person, you carry a bit of that, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and at the end of the day, you have so many problems upon your life that you bring upon yourself because of your covetousness of women. Say, I like that lady. Why don't you make your wife to look like the lady you marry, the lady you saw? What is in her that's not in your wife? And if your wife is not giving you joy, pray. I am an advocate of prayer. Pray and talk to yourselves. Communication helps a lot. You know, when I'm talking to people about marriage and communication and correction, I always tell them that you think that because you corrected a mistake that your husband or your wife made before, he must have learned. No. It has taken him or her maybe 20 years, 30 years to be who he is and who she is. If you are going to change that person, it's going to take some time. So you are going to have to keep saying it in a very nice way until he gets it. You are going to have to keep saying it in a nice way until she gets it. And many a time, what you are complaining about, he's not brought up to complain about that. There's this common story. You know toothpaste. One man was brought up to always press the paste from the bottom, so they press it. But the wife was not taught to press from the bottom, he just pressed anywhere. And every time the man would say, "What is your problem? Why can't you press the toothpaste from the bottom?" And it became a big fight. When they went for counseling, they told the man, "Listen, it will take time for this woman to understand. In the same way, it will take time. So learn to be patient. And please, don't castigate your wife. Don't disrespect your wife or your husband outside. If you disgrace her outside, you are not begging her inside. It doesn't make any sense. We all make mistakes. I don't have much time. Let me go to the next thing. You know, I wanted to say Samson was careless about the secret of his power. I'm told that the family that has the secret formula for coke, there is still something that nobody knows yet about coke, because they could keep the secret of the formula. I mean, before he was born, an angel told the mother, "His hair must not be cut." So when he was born, they keep telling him, "Your hair must not be cut, and don't let anybody know." And then he went to one prostitute. And because there are many people that are already looking for how to destroy Samson, the Philistines, they went to the prostitute and said, "We know that right now you are his girlfriend. Can you please help us to find out the secret of his power? Everybody knows he has a secret, but they don't understand what the secret is." And Delilah said to Samson, "Samson, I want to know the secret of your power. I mean, if something is not something is not wrong upstairs." The woman asked him four times. Yeah. The woman asked him four times. "Samson, tell me the secret of your power." I mean, okay, let us say, okay, maybe the woman just wanted to know, and then Samson told him the secret of his power. He lied to him at first. And the woman brought the Philistines to come and do what Samson said will make his power to disappear. When Samson saw that the woman brought the Philistines, excuse me, is he not supposed to run away from that woman? You know what he did? He still put his head on her lap again. And then the woman asked the same question the second time. And Samson lied to him again. And the woman brought the Philistines to come and do what Samson said. I don't know what happened. Maybe because the Bible says the soul that sinned shall die. I believe Samson has died in his mind. He wasn't thinking right. Because if he was thinking right, I don't think he would have spoken. Once you said it once and then the woman tried it again, you should find a way to move out of that environment to preserve his destiny, to preserve his calling, and to preserve the nation. But no, he allowed loose talk to make him speak. He just spew out the secret of his power. And when he spew out the secret of his power, you know what happened? The power went away. It became a sad story. Finally, his enemy got him. But you know what pained me more? The enemy started saying to themselves, "Our God has given us the man that destroys us." It's not their God, it's the man's carelessness. There are many of us that are watching me right now, your enemy is rejoicing about your downfall. But the truth is that they are not the one that actually make the downfall to come. You are the one. You disobey. I have this young man, he's one of my sons in Nigeria. at a particular time, his uncle's wife died. And the uncle, according to their custom, is not supposed to follow them to bury the wife because he wanted to take the wife to their village. So this young man said he was going to go. And then he had a revelation by himself that somebody appeared to him in his dream and tell him, don't go. If you go, there's danger ahead. His senior sister in their village had a dream telling him that he should not come home. He saw a dream that after he come back from that burial, things are going to go bad for him. One of his junior sister had a dream. You know what? This young man went. He went for the burial. He took the corpse home. But when he came back, his business did not go back to ground level. His business went under the ground. He lost everything. He lost everything and he was greatly in debt. It took him almost, it took prayers, intercession. Right now, he's just trying to come back to normal. It could have been avoided if he had listened to instruction. Yeah. I know that there are enemies against our destinies. If you're a man or a woman that had great gifting, great destiny, Satan will always be looking for how to attack you. But don't give Satan an open door by rebellion, by disobedience, by being foolish. I remember this man in London. I won't mention his name on air, but he's a popular London fashion designer. At a time when I was in London, this man was telling me about the encounter he was having with occultic power, satanic spirit, all these man-made women coming around him. And you know why? Because he had special gifting to sew clothes. He sews clothes, and for those that do all this their fashion, whatever they call it, fashion, when people will be coming out with different kind of fashion, with that kind of attire and different style, that's what he does in London. I'm not going to mention his name. He received a lot of awards. But I told him that time, and that was a time when he had a lot of challenge. He had problem with paying his rent. I said to him, do not deny God and do not allow the enemy to win. Keep your faith. And he said he's going to do that. Years later, God started opening doors for this man. He became famous. He was receiving awards in America, here in London, in Nigeria, in other African countries. He became great. The greater your glory is, the greater the opposition that will come against you. You've got to know that. But you see, many of these oppositions, you see, the Bible says there is no temptation that comes your way that is not common, and God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted above what you are able to bear, and he will make a way of escape for you. God will always give you that grace to overcome. Samson made that mistake, and it became an error in his life. Samson lost his eyes. He lost his sight. Of course, that was because of his foolishness. He would not have lost his eyes if he didn't give his secret out. You have to learn to keep your secret. It's not everything you say to everybody. I make that mistake many times also. I say things I'm not supposed to say. Nobody is perfect. I'm improving on myself. You should also do the same thing. Samson lost his eyes, but the greatest mistake Samson made was that he prayed to God. You know, the Bible says his ear began to grow again after it was shaven. To me, the growing of the ear is God's way of giving him a second chance. But he would still have done a lot of exploits, even without the eyes. But he prayed and said, God, give me strength just this one time. Let me die with the Philistines. He used his mouth to bury the remaining part of his destiny. Somebody said, how do you know that? Because when you look at the story of the kings in the Bible, all of them that fear God and do what God said, they always reign for 40 years or more. But those who do not please God always reign for less than 40 years. Some even reign for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. Samson only reigned for 20 years. He wished that he would die with the enemy. Listen, no matter how hard things are for you, don't ever wish that you will die with the enemy. Because if you wish it, you will have it. The secret of glory and power. Before I go, and end this episode, let me give you success secret for today. The last thing I told you, that you must have to put God first. Today I'm telling you that you have to identify your gifting. The Bible says the gift of a man will make room for him. The gift of a man will make room for him. In other words, everybody has what it takes to get to the top. You know, the top is so vast that there are a lot of spaces up there, but the down is too crowded. You've got to learn to soar. Let the hand of God take you up. And if that is going to happen, number one, you have to fear God. Number two, you have to identify your gifting. Identifying gifting is not just praying and seeing vision. I'm talking about search inside and ask yourself, what do I love to do? What special ability do I have? Because nobody is born into this world empty. You have potential. You have talent. Find it out. Don't allow the rat race. You want to do two jobs. You want to pay bills. Don't let it blindfold you. Sit down and ask yourself the question, what are my giftings? What gift do I have? Many of us, we are like that that guy that buried his one talent. As a pastor, maybe you don't, for that, maybe you have only 10, 20 people in your church. Be proud of it and keep building them. Don't go to Satan to get more people. Keep building them up. Because he that is faithful in least shall be faithful in much. Identify your gifting and be satisfied with your gift. Stop desiring another person's gift. Identify your own and satisfy it. By the time that Sam Adeyemi started preaching on success in Nigeria, success message was not popular, but he stick to it. Today, many other people have started preaching success, but he started it, and he became great. It's time for you also to take advantage of giftings so that you can move up. And that reminds me, there's one gifting I have. It's a grace that God gave me. And that is the grace to prosper men. I've seen this happen over 20 years now. Everyone who does business with me always end up getting expanded and getting enlarged. I'm not just a pastor. I'm into businesses, and I relate to people also on business life. And one thing I've also discovered is that when you bring your advert to this program, you are doing business with me. Two things are going to happen. Number one, your business will be growing, because as I'm thanking God that the program is going forward, and then very soon we become 1 hour, and then we have more than one day in a week. It's going to be determined by how many slots we have. You can choose to say to yourself, I want to support this program. I want to bring my advertisement to this program. Call the number on the screen. Let's talk. We have discount for the first 20 people that call. Just call and let's discuss together. And as you support me in making this program work, you begin to see explosion, expansion, and you begin to see greatness. Call the number on the screen. And if you have ideas, you have stories you want us to share, story of failure and then success, call that number. I will get across to you. I will hear about the story, and then we can see if it is television worthy, and we can share it. I've got to go right now because time is not always on my side, but I'm going to come back again next week. And I believe, God, that the glory and the power God has given to you will not fade. God bless you. I'm Reverend Sam. Bye-bye.